Thank you. Well, praise God. It's been an exciting week of seeing God move and being led by Him, being in His service. I just absolutely rejoice in being able to be in His service. Would you turn up the sound a little bit when you get time there, Frank? Serving God, there is no greater pleasure. Do you realize the angels serve Him 24 hours a day? Without a complaint department, no less. Our complaint department is big. If we serve the Lord a little bit, we think we got a right to complain because we get a little moan here. Not so. If we could just behold Him in our hearts and in our minds and in our thoughts. And you know, that's the thing about growing in the Word and growing in the Spirit. As we gain more, not just knowledge about Him, but a revelation of Him. Jesus Christ is supposed to be a revelation. Something that's revealed to us. God's kingdom is supposed to be a revelation. Something that's revealed to us. It can't be revealed unless we cry out to the Holy Spirit, would you please reveal these things to me? Because they are not known. Our natural mind does not know spiritual things and is not acquainted with spiritual things of God. So He's calling you to that. I hope and pray that you've been calling out to Him, because if you've been calling out to Him, Lord, I want more of You, you couldn't do that unless He was calling you to Him. He said, no man comes to Him except He call him. And so if you have a draw in your heart that you want to know God, if you have a draw that you want to move closer, you want to have a new heart, that's Him calling you and saying, come, let me change what's in there. Come to me. Let me change what's in there. He loves you. He wants relationship with you. To me, that's as abstract as me wanting relationship with a pig in a pen. Because that's what we are as human beings. And then when we see our condition, we're supposed to cry out, Lord, can You change me from a pig? And He has that ability. And He has the ability to help us out of the pig pen. He has the ability to transform us. He has the ability to make us into something lovable before Him and something loving before Him, something that we are not. All the changes that has occurred in your life as a result of Him calling you and Him training you. So would you call upon Him this morning and say, Lord, here I am. I want to see You. I want to hear You. I want to feel You. I want to know You. I need You, Lord. I need You. If He senses your earnestness, then perhaps your spiritual sensors will begin to turn on. Because what mountain is there that He can hide behind? He's not just a reading in a book and reading about someone. He's real. And so we need the spiritual equipment to be able to sense Him. He can temporarily give you vision to see Him if you don't have that equipment installed yet. He loves doing that. He loves revealing Himself. So you call out to Him and say, Lord, I really love You. I really need a visitation of You. And you give Him invitation. Before we do that, if you have a little dirt on you, you know, all you got to do is say, Lord, I repent. Forgiveness is based on repentance, is it not? So whatever comes up in your heart, you've been doing it, you know you're not supposed to be doing, the words you're saying, your actions, your attitude, if that pops up on the radar right now, just say, Lord, I really don't want to do that. I hadn't figured out how not to, but I don't want to. Now see, there's resistance, and there's a desire to want to change that. And then you can ask Him for empowerment. But then based upon you wanting that change and willing not to do it again, forgiveness is available. That's what Jesus said. I came to bring and put people in a position that they can repent for forgiveness. So, shall we do a little bit of that right quick? Lord, we humbly come to You, Lord, and all those things in us that are not sanctioned of You, and it's just of our flesh that serves self. We ask, oh God, that You forgive us, and we do want to change that. We want to be spiritual people. Help us to become spiritual people, Lord. Now wash us and forgive us, that we might be clean to be able to receive from You. If we don't renounce the flesh, how can you come and give spiritual into that which is contaminated with flesh or self-centered purposes? So free us from those things, that we might be able to be receiving from you and be transformed into a being that can walk with you. In Jesus' great and powerful name, I pray. Holy Spirit, we call upon you and ask you to come and stand in our midst as God's representative and Jesus' representative, and lead us into high praise and worship of our great King. For he indeed is worthy of our praise. He indeed is worthy. For his majesty covers not only the universe, but it covers our life too. So open our eyes that we might worship him and praise him. And come into our midst and speak to us through your great power. And bring words of truth to us as we worship our great King. In Jesus' name, amen.
I want to know you more. for the highest goal, that I might receive the prize. Pressing onward, pushing every hindrance aside, out of my way, 'cause I want to know you more. I want to know you. I want to hear your voice. I want to know you more, Jesus. I want to touch you. I want to see your face. I want to know you more.
I want to know you.
I want to know you. I want to hear your voice. To know you more,
more and more.
And I want to touch you. I want to see your face. I want to know you more.
Oh, we want to know you, Lord. Oh, we want to know you more and more. Oh, to see you, Jesus.
To know you more.
Hear me when I call, O God, of my righteousness. You have relieved me in my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long, O you sons of men, will you turn my glory to shame? How long will you love worthlessness and seek falsehood? But know that I, the Lord, have set apart for myself him who is godly. The Lord will hear when I call upon him. My child, I say to you today, I do hear your voices. I do hear your prayers. Those of you who in righteousness call upon me, I hear you. I want you to know today that I have set in your midst a pastor, a shepherd, one whom I have called. He is my great gift to you. I send him on rescue and recovery missions. He has been busy pruning away the vegetation of the trail that would hide this trail that leads to me. He works hard on your behalf. He carries you in his heart as I do. He has been pruning back the things that come from the world and the flesh and the devil that would hide this way into my presence. He works hard at it. He is my anointed.
I have set my hand upon him. He is mine. He is my gift to you. Receive him as my gift.
And I am in your midst now, today. I am here to bring freedom and to bring enlightenment. I'm here to breathe the breath of my life into your face. Receive what I have for you. Receive the gifts with great joy. I want you to walk in light and in truth and in joy. I want you to know who you are. And I want you to know me. And I want you to know that I have come with great power by my Spirit to bring transformation to you, to sort and sift that which is of me and that which is not. Allow me to be God. Allow me to transform you. Allow me to do the work. Wait on me. Praise me. Know that I am a holy God and that I am here because I love you and on your behalf. Much has been given to you and much will be required.
But in a sense, you don't know us unless we bow our knee to you and seek you and pour out our hearts to you and reveal our need for you, our knowledge of how much you mean to us, how much you enrich our lives, and how much you desire us, oh Lord. How we long for you to pour out your presence upon us. Oh, I thank you, Lord, that you have given us this grace, Lord, that we could know you. That we could enjoy your presence and behold your beauty. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you for loving us so. Thank you for desiring us and making it possible for us to know you like this. It is such a gift to us. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Oh, light a fire in us, Lord Jesus.
My God. Oh, I want to know you, and I
Fireworks. Well, praise God. I am absolutely overjoyed in your participation in Proverbs. Proverbs would not exist without you. You are the mainstay and the core of that. And it's just absolutely amazing that we, this little bitty ragtag group of us before the Lord, is able to do such a mighty, mighty work. And I constantly get compliments about you being a body and people's mouths falling open that are in large churches that can't even pull off a little supper for themselves. And I think, my goodness, God has sent servants. He has sent servants. You have a servant's heart, and I praise God that you have a servant's heart. And in the midst of that, being his servant, guess what? We get to be in behind the curtain with him. That's what his servants are. His servants were the priests that got to go behind the curtain. So as we serve him, we also will have encounters with him. And it will do something for us inside. And I just give you high praise. I give you high praise for all that you have done. And you would not believe all the breakthroughs as ladies are having in the midst of Proverbs. And I realize it's a shallow end of the pool, but hey, it's nice to have a shallow end in case somebody don't have legs. They need a place to float, don't they? And when somebody hadn't even swum before, they need some floaties and they need a safe place for that to take place. But that's not to say there's not some deep water somewhere at the end of it, because all kinds of ladies come up to Jackie and some of the others and want prayer and want to move on in God. It is our desire to keep that established for him. It is our desire to see him move upon lives and change and transform those so that we can walk wholly in his presence, because it's the only safe place to walk. How many of you know the world's not a safe place to walk? The enemy's not a safe companion. The world's not a safe companion. So the only companion that we can have that is safe is our Lord Jesus Christ. You're not a safe companion for yourself. With that, why don't we pray? Is there any announcements? Oh, take an offering. Yeah, the guys are waiting. What are they waiting for back there? Thank you. I need a handler up here. Gentlemen, would you come forward as we continue our worship? By presenting our offering, many people don't realize and they miss the bountiful blessing by not offering before the Lord. So, Lord, would you extend your hands, please? Would you come and would you lay your hands upon this which is being given by those whom you've instructed to give, that they might receive your bountiful blessing? Would you multiply it for your kingdom? Would you multiply it and cause those that you have out there that you want to know you, cause them to be brought into your kingdom? Bless it and multiply it in Jesus' great and powerful name, I pray. Amen.
For those of you on the children's ministry team, we're going to have our little meeting afterwards, our monthly get-together after service today, which only take about 10 or 15 minutes or so. So if you could hang out around here so we could do that real quick. And then also we have a wedding that's going to be happening around here. I forget who it is. I don't remember who is supposed to be getting married here, but somebody is, and it's going to happen on March 2nd. And that's a Sunday, so we'll have the service, the wedding after service, and we'll have a potluck after that. So if you'd be thinking ahead about that, what you might want to bring, of course, it's our wonderful Charlene and Kale, and they're going to be handed out invitations. So if you don't get one, you know, sorry, you're not invited. No, please come. They would love to have you be a part of the day. And as we all enjoyed Nancy and Mark's wedding last fall, which was so awesome to be a part of and amazing what God did. I'm sure Kale and Charlene's won't look anything like that because it'll be individual to them. And the Lord will, as they make their vows before Him, and we stand as witnesses to that. We just can't wait to see what God does in that. So just give them a hug, rejoice with them, because it's a pretty credible story that the Lord has done right there, and right in front of us. Seems like there was something else, but, you know, we'll just forget about it. No prayer meeting tonight. Yeah. That was the other thing. So, because of Proverbs, you know, we don't do prayer meeting on that. So you can go home and collapse after all your hard work to pull that off. Like Curtis said, thank you guys. Saturday's meeting was amazing, truly amazing. I think I had more women come up to me afterwards, not only in the general meeting, but in the workshops, after their workshops too, saying they heard exactly what they needed to hear for that day. I also had a woman come up to me and tell me that she had been inviting a coworker of hers who isn't saved, doesn't know the Lord. She had invited her a couple of years at the Christmas meeting, and she came, and then she's been inviting her all year long to come to a Proverbs, and she's either had to work or something's going on. She's a single mom of three little girls, and so busy on Saturdays. Well, she'd been asking all year, asked again at the Christmas meeting. The lady had to work. But her 11-year-old daughter said, "Can I go?" And this woman said, "Why, sure, you can come." So she brought her to the Christmas meeting, and the little girl said, "Do they do this often?" And the woman said, "Yes, we do it every month." And she said, "Do you think I could come again?" And she said, "Sure." She said, "I can't come. I'm not coming next month on January because they had something at their church. And so, but you can come the next time if it's okay with your mom." Well, the little girl was so excited about it, she kept pestering her mother to come. So her mother came this week, and I got to meet them. They came up to me afterwards, and I got to meet both mother and the daughter. And they were, the mother even said, "That was really amazing. It's a lot for me to think about." And I just went, "Wow, cool." You know, think about it. And I didn't know their story at the time. And the little girl was the one, she won one of the gift baskets. And then she won three of the little treat things to give away. I mean, she was beaming. She was beaming. And she has these two little other sisters. And she gave something else that she won to somebody else. And her table won the game. And so she was just loaded when she walked out of here, this little girl. And when she met me, she just took my hand. She said, "It's so nice to meet you." And she was just like, just about to explode. She was so blessed. So it's amazing that, and the woman that brought them afterwards said, "You know, if I have to go through the children to get the mom here, then that's what I'll do." And so it's amazing the lives that are being touched, opportunity for the Lord to touch hearts. So good job, guys. Good job. It's incredible.
What do you think that little girl is going to feel towards God for the rest of her life? She's going to know that He has a banquet table. She's going to know everything could be wonderful in His presence. Even though her mother is an unbeliever and she's not in church and all that stuff, God's already calling out to her. And she's responding. She begged her mother, "Mom, can we go? Can we go? Come on. Oh, come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on." And the other lady that invited the little girl said, I'll get them there even if I have to go through their kids. I thought, you go get them, girl. But even so, in the midst of that, I'm praying for the mother, of course, but 11-year-old, sincere, responsive to the Lord, longing for God in the midst of the worship, longing. And it just delights my soul. And, of course, the stories go on and on. The blog of them speaking or putting things on the website is just phenomenal, of all that God's speaking to them. And I thank you for your participation. Without you, we would not have Proverbs University. You are Proverbs University, and I am deeply in debt to you for helping us accomplish something that God wants done. And it's an amazing thing to do something that God wants done. Gary?
Can I want to add something that Elton said.
Okay.
Can I do that?
Yeah.
Elton had mentioned the gift, both Christ and you, and the pathway that our shepherd continually clears out so we can find. We already know the cross, but the presence of God in all that. And I've always viewed my salvation as a gift. And the only other gift up until this point I ever felt the Lord gave me was my wife. At the same time, he proved that he had a sense of humor, obviously. But I've never really seen it much different than that. But because we spend so much time clearing brush and knocking things down and picking stuff up, because somebody wants to see what's on the other side of what we do, it just dawned on me. I've often tried to describe it to somebody other than this guy that we all try to describe, and it often offends people that we know somebody that knows so much about God, that's so in touch with God. How can that be? And so from what Elton's description of you clearing paths, because there's a lot of Christian people that think all paths lead to Christ, and they don't. They're rabbit trails left and right. And for me and my house, I just want to thank you for going through the forest and the brambles and cutting them out so that we can get into the presence of God. And as great as Proverbs 31 is, and the calling on Jackie's heart to do it, without your, and I want to say leadership, without your humility, your humbleness, and your tenacity to follow Christ at all costs, every day, all the time, that's Proverbs is the fruit of that in my estimation. And I just want to thank you that you are truly, for Gail and I, you are a gift. And thank you.
Well, thank you. It seems like y'all have given me a badge of honor, but if I wear it, then you'll have to take it back because I wouldn't be humble, right? How about we get on in the Word and ask God to speak to us? That's our greatest desire, is that He would speak to us and lead us. Lord, we bow our hearts before You to receive from You Your instruction, Your Word of life that will transform us, and Your heart and Your mind. We state that we will hear and we will obey. So please, install Your living Word within us and enable us to receive it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Have a quick video for you, and then we'll get into the service. You can make up the sound that's... I'm sure it's got some sound effects. Can you see the ship is now broken in half?
Yeah.
Slowed it down with cargo. Isn't that a nice little harbor? See, God provides, that's what church is supposed to be about. Us being in a safe place. Have you got any more, Frank?
One
more. Okay. Two more. That's it? Okay. We'll get on then with our thoughts and our minds. We are in a study called God's Greatest for Your Life. We can always make it up. Before we come to Christ, we're making it up, aren't we? Before we come to Christ, we've got our own greatest in mind. Got our rock star music, if you were of that set. You've got all your stuff you surrounded yourself with. And Jesus whispers to you, and it usually happens when your boat has hit the rocks. I mean, a lot of people, most of them start out their Christianity when the boat has struck the rocks. They've lost the cargo, are going to lose the cargo as a result of being out in high seas. And I call the high seas our will, our way, our determination, our purposes, our self. And Jesus realizes we are always sailing those high seas, which will eventually crush us and which will eventually sink us, and we will die two deaths, a physical death and a spiritual death. And so He has come to rescue us, to become His, to come into His marina. And how many of you know that there's a harbor captain? There is someone in charge of you docking that tells you that that's not your spot. You know, you're Pier 14 down here, and we have provisions for you down here. So God is the one that orchestrates those things, and all we can do is when we come to His harbor, is say to the harbor master, yes, I will park there. And if we will, then we get electricity, we get power, we get food, we get everything that we need is there at the dock. And we are supposed to begin to live our lives there in His presence, not out on the high seas. So before we come to Christ, this was our state, we were on the high seas. I can remember, I love sailing, I had a sailboat before we moved up here, and I would read sailing articles all the time, and somebody had about a 54-foot double-ender, which can handle heavy seas with a deep hull, deep keel, and all that stuff, and they were somewhere between New Zealand and Chile, sailing around, you know, the world. And see, if you sail, you got the wind, it's free, you owe nobody nothing, nobody can come and collect taxes from you, and you got your own stores of food, and it's all about your pleasure. But what they didn't know, one day the sea started getting rough, and they were in that for 3 days, and the waves got so big that their double-ender, a wave was coming through head-on with it, and the wave was so tall, it took the ship up so far that it turned it completely over upside down. Didn't roll it over. Now, that takes at least a 150-foot wave to do that, in which the sea is notorious for having waves like that, that can sink us. So all of our greatest that we plan for our lives is sinkable and will sink and will bring tragedy. As I stated, most people I have met have gone through tragedy after tragedy after tragedy by making the wrong decisions in their life. And so God's desire is that we have a great life, but it is in Him. It's not our great life. It's His great life that we come and we live in, not ours. Making that change is life-threatening to you. And the reason I say it's life-threatening, it means you have to give up your life, your pursuits, your wants, your desires to pursue Him and His life and His wants and His desires. I can always tell when I meet someone that says they're a Christian and they say their desires are for God, and if I visit their house, they've got every latest gadget that there is. They can only live with the most perfect. They have to have the best. And they've surrounded their little playpen with everything that there is. And I think, you don't have time for God. And you've surrounded yourself with, why are you different than the person that before they came to Christ? Before they came to Christ, we had our stuff. And after we come to Christ, then do we use God to say, I want my stuff, and now you're making it legal that I can get my stuff? I don't think so. I think we're supposed to surrender all to Jesus, and those things are supposed to be being used in the kingdom of God, and He'll leave us, no doubt, with a little bit of comfort if we're His servant. But if we're going to find God's greatest, we have to make a determination. Do we want that? Because there's some people that don't. They don't want God's greatest. They want their greatest plan. And you're going to have to face up to the truth of that, of whether you want that. So the first thing in pursuing God, you got to make a decision. Because I can tell you, being a Christian is not a bed of roses. Being a Christian means I surrender to You, O God. All the apostles that surrendered, the new church that surrendered, Jesus that surrendered, you show me where that wasn't necessarily profitable for them other than the spiritual part. Now, I will make this statement that if you follow God that, and you give Him everything that you have, now He becomes responsible for you for the maintenance and upkeep and care of your future. If you don't give Him everything that you have, you might still belong to Him, but you're still responsible for that maintenance and upkeep and your future. And I promise you, you're going to be laying in a hospital or a nursing home or somewhere, and you're going to have a need. And because you own the facility, you've refused His ability to be your healer, your God. So we must understand, if we desire His greatest for our life, we're supposed to desire His plan. Is that up? Yeah, it's already up. We're supposed to desire His purposes. We're supposed to desire His ways. We're supposed to desire His desires. Jesus said, oh God, not my will be done, but Yours, Father. He was always desiring His desire. Now, if we're going to do that, we need a heart to do that with. So one of the first desires we need is, oh God, I desire a heart to do that. And I'm selfish. I want to be safe. I want my stuff in my little crib here, my playpen, and I'm not safe without it. You know, my daughter, when she was a babe, she loved buttons. You just get over her crib, and I'd buy her something. It just had a zillion buttons on it, and she was happy. See, we like buttons that don't do nothing. We like shiny things, too. And, of course, God grows us up to where we stop desiring that. Don't settle for less. Because if you settle for less, you're going to be that ship on those rocks in the future. And you're going to be waving at me. And you see the helicopter come by. And there was a cable that went down. And one person got on that. And the ship was literally broken in half. And if you've seen it on the internet, you also see that it was laden down with cargo. That's the first thing I see when people that know Christ want to head out to the high seas. Oh, I've got plenty. They stack it up on their decks and make themselves safe. And I'm thinking, oh, you're fixing to put out to sea, aren't you? You've got your own supply. You don't need God anymore. It's your supply. I get nervous for them because there is no winning against the sea. It will rage until you sink. And yeah, you may be a good seaman, but without God, there's always going to be a wave that will take you. There's always going to be something under there that will get you. And so we can't substitute. If we want God's greatest for our lives, we cannot substitute. What we want to substitute is our plan. What we want to substitute is our way. What we want to substitute is our purposes. What we want to substitute is our desires. So the first, number one thing, if you want God's greatest in your life, which is achievable. He can empower you through His Word and empower you through His Spirit. The first thing that we looked at was the don't settle for less. You got to want it. Make a decision. Don't lie to yourself. If you want to be your own supplier and hide and be in your own little crib with all your toys, you're lying to yourself. That's not a surrender to Jesus. That's the substitute of your plan. And you're calling it Jesus. I meet many Christians that substitute their plan and call it Jesus, saying, well, I heard. And I told you last week we were going to be talking about hearing God. It is a delightful thing to learn how to hear God, but let's go through the things that we've covered so far. We've covered principle number two is to fix your eyes upon Jesus. If your eyes upon yourself and you're constantly looking in the mirror, it's all about you. If your eyes upon Jesus and be all about Him and all about His business, and you'll be a servant. If they're all about you, you won't be a servant. It'll cringe you. It'll make you hide. It'll make you crawl up in some corner. I don't want to be a servant. I don't want to serve. You'll get all paranoid, and then that gives the enemy a chance to come. Now, keep in mind, Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 says, let us run the race that is set before us. You don't get to pick the race. You don't choose where you want to race to, race from, or where you're going to race at. Jesus is the one who establishes where you're supposed to race and what you're supposed to race. You're just supposed to take your little legs and follow the path and run at it. Run at His path, not yours. So there's a race that can be set before you. And many people in Christendom don't want that race. Instead, they want their comfort and they want their playpen and they want their gadgets, they want their toys. If you're willing to run that race and you show up for that race, then it says you can fix your eyes on Jesus. If you're not showing up for the race, what makes you think you're going to see Jesus? He's there at the starting line. And come on, let's get started. My way. Come on, it's over here. Get up signs. It's over here. And all the shiny things of life are all around us that we want to say, oh, well, Jesus said it's okay, I can do this and I can do that. And we're going to talk about hearing. It's impossible to hear without the Spirit. And all you'll do is be talking to yourself. And we did that before we came to Christ. So there's some things we have to look at. If we are willing to run the race, then and we fix our eyes upon Jesus and we line up at the starting gate to do it His way. It means there's going to be lots of changes. It means I don't get to do it my way anymore, right? Lots of changes. But in that is all the provision that we need. Either you're the provider or you run His race and you let Him provide. And remember, if you line up for this, you'll get to see Him. If you line up for this, then He is the author that He is writing down what your life will amount to. You want your life to amount something in Him? If you were to stand before Him right now, how much would it amount to? How much have you done for Him? How much have you done in His kingdom? How much have you sold out to Him for? I can tell you all this world is perishing, and when we perish, we will stand before Him and we'll give an account of what we didn't do that we were slated to do. You were slated to live a life for God, and He For some reason, he's insane. He thinks this body belongs to him if I belong to him. He thinks this body is supposed to go do something for him, but yet I've got every excuse under the sun, and it's not supposed to do anything for him, and you're supposed to do something for me. I'll let you be God if you give me everything I want. God didn't pass out pacifiers. He didn't let us be babies for very long. It's okay when you start if you're a baby. It's okay. It's okay that you wear diapers. It's okay that you're incontinent. It's okay that you can't walk. It's okay if you're a baby. We've talked about that in one of our deals. Another thing that happens is if we look upon him, then we become radiant. His brightness, his light begins to enter into us because we've made a decision to do it his way and carry through. Many tell me, I'm going to do that, but they don't carry through. It says, and their faces will not be ashamed. So if we fix our eyes upon Jesus, one, he establishes the pathway for us. He establishes it as a race. He establishes it to him as a starter. He establishes that he's going to write down the path. He'll walk with you on that. And he establishes that he will perfect your faith. And there's many baby Christians that are not far from death because they never grew up. Because they didn't get up at the gate. Instead, they just wanted the fire insurance to get into heaven and say, well, I pray, I do all this, and they're not doing anything for God. Instead, everything they do is for themselves, and even the prayers become self-centered. If we're not going to be ashamed, that means we have to be responsive to him, right? If you can be responsive to him, that means you're busy about his business. 1 Peter 1:13, therefore prepare your minds for action, keep sober in spirit, and fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. We're supposed to have and expect a revelation of Jesus Christ, him being revealed to us. You cannot expect that if you don't line up for the race, right? So, in this principle of fix your eyes on Jesus, he goes on, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the demands of the selfish desires of your heart, which were once yours in your ignorance. Do you realize before we came to Christ, we had selfish desires, and we were in ignorance. The problem is, we received Jesus, and somebody has given us a false hall pass that it's okay, you don't have to change, and we kept our selfish desires, and we prayed more about our selfish desires, and we wanted our storehouses. We wanted more and more and more. Now we're using God to get more and more and more and more. That's a selfish desire of your heart, which was once in ignorance. But if you know Jesus Christ, you're not ignorant anymore. And you've given yourself an excuse not to do what you know to do. And you're lazy. And in that laziness, I have to give you warning when you stand before him. He's going to look you in the eye and you're going to agree. And he's going to ask you, why didn't you do something in your life for me? Why weren't you directed by me? Is that a legitimate question since it's his earth? Now, if you've done something for yourself using him, that doesn't qualify. That's for you and that's the self. And we need to separate out the two. And the reason we do, you want to hear from him? Because I can tell you that back in the turn of the century, they didn't have radios. The sea was still there. Ships were still going out to seas. So they set up lighthouses. We'll set up lighthouses. If you put up your own lighthouses, then you don't know what was under the sea and when the tide would be out and where the rocks are. But we have a tendency to set up our own lighthouses of where it's safe. What's safe? Instead, if you have noticed, it's the government who sets up the lighthouses because they know where all the rock piles are. They know where the waves are and they know where the currents are. They're the ones that set up the lighthouse. We can't set up a lighthouse. Jesus has his lighthouses, and we can't move them. If we move them, we lose our position. Another thing that they didn't have was they didn't have radios to talk to each other. Another thing they didn't have was any form of communication to each other, even from ship to ship. And whenever it was foggy, the best you could do from land was set up these huge fog horns that you could hear for miles. But when you're in dense fog, you can't tell which direction that's coming from. All it's telling is, do you know there's danger and you're fixing to sink because you're too close to land because you can hear this. Right? You're too close to the rocks. So, we go on here. God has called us to be holy. You read that. Two most important senses we have are our eyes, and that's so we can see the way. Jesus has a way for us. Now, the problem is, you don't get to choose that way. He's the one that chose that way. He's the one that chose his instructions through Scripture. He's the one that chose it through his overseers over you. And he also gave you eyes so you could see danger. But what do we use our eyes for is seeing pleasure. As Scripture says, in the last days, man will desire pleasure more than they'll be lovers of pleasure more than they are lovers of God. So the eyes must be fixed on Jesus. But also, you need somebody to certify that what you're seeing is what you see. Do you realize that? We're delusional. We need certification. That's where the Scripture comes in. It's a giant magnifying glass for certification of what we see, that we're supposed to be seeing through God's eyes. Jesus was looking down as they were crucifying him, and they couldn't see what they were doing. They were filled with demonic forces. Demonic forces were speaking to him. They were flogging him. They were spitting in his face. They were jeering him. They were cussing at him. They were bloody mad. Die! Die, you heretic! They're screaming at the top of their lungs. And Jesus is seeing something different. He sees that their minds is filled with rage and demonic influence and self-influence, even though they were supposed to be religious. Even though they were supposed to be God's kids, he saw that they could not see the truth, and he prayed a prayer for them. Oh, Father, forgive them. They do not know what they were doing. Why? Because they couldn't see. So if we're going to see that the Holy Spirit is the one that enables us to see, but the Scripture is a magnifying glass as to whether what we see is true or not, because elsewise we're going to make up everything under the sun for everything excuse of getting to do our own way. Scripture says that our lives and our minds are extremely deceptive, that we don't even know what we think. Number three was meditate on God's Word, therefore putting aside all filthiness and all that remains of wickedness. Wickedness is, again, connected to my self-centered pursuits that are somehow induced by Satan that allows me to do what I want to do. Do you realize it was wickedness for Satan to be filled with himself and think he was wonderful? It was wickedness. Wickedness, the beginning wicked crime was what? Self. That was beginning wicked crime. And then followed rebellion. There had to be some disqualification of God and what he said. I'm sure Satan did that in his mind. Did you realize they disqualified Jesus, that he couldn't possibly be the Messiah? They disqualified his instruction. They disqualified his word. When Paul showed up on the scene, they disqualified what he had to say. He was a strong man of God. No, here's what Scripture says. Here's what the Bible says. Here's what the Spirit says. And I'm God's representative, and here's what I say. Now, he had the authority to do that, and he realized that. He realized that God put men of God in charge. And the priesthood were supposed to come out and make proclamations, and everybody was supposed to listen to that. If they didn't listen to that, then they were damned and sent to hell. Do you realize that? But if they did listen to it, then they received God's word. He said, you received God's word. Now, I know this is hard-hitting, but you got to understand, our flesh, it's just like a bowl full of jello, and it'll crawl out through any hole that it can. And then you wake up a week later and you got a bowl full of jello in your bed with you. And you go, I thought I got rid of that. How did you get it? Well, it leaked out and it crawled out and it crawled around the house. And so Jesus wants to eliminate the flesh within us. Why? Because the flesh mind is death, is it not? The self mind, the self pursuit mind is death, is what he says. Adam in the garden became all about self, because God withdrew his spirit from Adam. Withdrew it. So Adam was all about self. And I don't see any great regret in Adam, do you? I didn't see him falling on the ground. There was no account of him, oh God, forgive me. There was not even any forgiveness asked from this guy. Do you find a problem in that? I don't know if you've ever thought about it, but I think that was probably a greater problem.
then, and that's because he was filled with self all of a sudden. He ate of the tree that justifies man doing anything, and man becomes his own God, saying, this is okay. And Christian faith, if we're going to hear God, the part of the problem is we want to certify everything that we want to do. And God has his certification ways that we're supposed to do that. And one of the ways is if we think we hear God, it better line up with Scripture. And if it doesn't line up with Scripture, you're not hearing from God. Rule number one. Principle number one. Now, he also, we're supposed to put aside all filthiness and in humility receive the word implanted. Do you realize when Paul was writing to the different churches, the New Testament hadn't been written. But yet he's commanding them as from God. This is what God is saying. And the first thing the evil one does is approach us and, how do you know he's hearing from God? I mean, he's just taking too much upon himself. How do you know he's hearing from God? Well, we can hear from God too. That's what they did to Moses, and God got all upset. He seemed to think if he spoke through Moses that that was a word of God. The people seemed to think, well, that's words coming from a man. God said, no, it's not. That's me speaking through a man. If you don't want to receive it, you're in hot water. And I can tell you, over 2 million men died out there with their wives and with their children that didn't believe, and God raised up a whole new generation. They were constantly fighting about God's Word. God's Word was incarnate within Moses, was it not? God's Word was incarnate within Paul. God's Word was incarnate within Jesus Christ. So my point is you're supposed to receive the Word in humility, and you're supposed to receive it implanted within you. That's why we're given leaders and overseers. But prove yourself doer of the Word, and do not merely be hearers who delude themselves. Many people hear the Word, say, yeah, I heard that, I know that. Well, you're not living it, you hadn't lived it, then you don't know it, and you're not a doer of the Word. The second we start violating these principles, we lose God's greatest for our life. Now, the reason I'm hitting these points is because I want you to find God's greatest for your life, and here's the way that we ants out, and we never enter into God's way for our life. Instead, we modify what he has to say. Stop modifying. Accept Scripture. If it tells you don't lie, don't lie. If it tells you don't cheat, don't cheat. If it tells you be obedient to the leaders that God puts over you, then do that. If it tells you to take and trust the Word, then trust it. If it tells you to get filled with the Holy Spirit, then what are you waiting for? If it tells you you're supposed to be God's servant, what are you waiting for? See, we're violators of God's Word through some sort of justification that's within us. And so we have to talk about hearing God and getting rid of our justifications for not loving Him enough to want to serve Him. Because you can love yourself so much that you'll serve yourself. Whoever you love, that's who you'll serve. Whoever you love, your barn will reflect that. That's your stuff that you store up. Come to my house, you're going to see 800 books. You're going to see used furniture that we bought different places just to survive. We started on Apple boxes. You're not going to see the latest, greatest gadgets other than if it's a tool that's used for God, like one of those computers back there. Everything we own is purchased that way. Most of our clothes are purchased that way. Or if Macy's puts a shirt on sale or a sweater on sale for $2.99, it was. I bought 20 sweaters down there. Went to a vest. That's why y'all call me that. What is it? The Argyle guy. You just think I love Argyle. No, I walked in there and they had 20 vests that fit me, that were wonderful, that were like $70 a piece, and they were marked down to $2.99. I said, well, I'll take the stack. So you think I'm the Argyle man? No. If you get tired of seeing Argyle, just take up a collection and buy me a different sweater. Now, if I was all about myself, I would have to have, did you know? I mean, you can buy a vest that, I mean, it'll almost make you fly. It's only $800. And the self said, oh, got to have that. Gotta have that. I'm certainly God wants His best for me. I gotta have that best. If you're faced with always gotta have the best, you're selfish, and you need to own up to it and look at it. And you can't say that God wanted you to have that $800 vest. You can't. That could have been used in the kingdom for His purposes. And you'll be shorting yourself and your future, and you'll be shorting God, and you'll be bankrupt. We're going to have to talk about that. Prove yourselves to be doers of the word. We're in principle number 3. I've written to you, young men, because you are strong in the word. The word of God abides in you. You're willing to abide in it. That means do it. Now, if you have to do it, I guess I'm going to have to do this. You're not abiding in it. You're resisting. You don't like it. You don't want it. You don't want God's greatest. And inside, you're going to have an emotional pity party that you don't like what's being done. Well, we're supposed to delight to do God's will. We're supposed to delight in that. And if you want to delight, if you want things to change in your heart, you've got to delight in those things that are laid before you. God told me a long time ago, He said, Curtis, whatever I lay before you, do with all your might. And so I've always counted it a shame if something's laid before me and I don't do it with all my might. It's a shame for me. But not only is it a shame for me because I didn't do it with all my might, I didn't line up for the race. And because I didn't line up for the race, guess who I didn't get to see? Then I have to start making it up. I find many supposedly mature Christians that are making it up so that they can support their flesh. If we're going to let God's word abide within us, then we're going to overcome the evil one. Now, we love overcoming the evil one, you know? You know who the evil one is? That's someone else who disagrees with you. That's what we want to make it up to be. Oh, it's somebody else, you know? I can tell somebody the truth, and all of a sudden, I'm the evil one. I can tell what God's word said, and, oh, you're condemning me. You're the evil one. If we will take God's word inside of us, then the evil one who comes to speak to you, you will recognize there's someone else here speaking to me, and I want nothing to do with you, Satan. Go away from me. I need to have some classes on to teach you how to hear when Satan's speaking to you. You realize he still speaks, right? You realize the scripture says our fight is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers of darkness in high places. That means that your fight is against these creatures of darkness that are real. They're eternal creatures. They will live forever and have lived since God created them. And there's an eternal place that they will go, and it's a fiery pit that they will be tortured forever and ever and ever and ever. Why? Because they are forever and ever and ever. And smoke rises up in heaven, and God can see it from the throne, and so can Jesus Christ. And all the angels are cheering that He brought justice, and everything that was evil that didn't want to do it God's way is in there. Everything that was selfish is in there. If you become selfish enough, you'll have your arms wrapped around Him, because Satan is the one that authorizes you to cut down God's word and do it different. Satan's the one that authorizes you to be God instead of your overseers and those that God put over you. You must be a doer. Elsewise, the enemy will come. The evil one will come. Is God a liar? He says the evil one will come. You're going to have a visitation of Him. And when you do, what are you going to do? When you're on the rocks piled up and you watch everything being washed out to sea, you cannot salvage anything. Romans number 4, become filled and obedient to the Holy Spirit. Many people make the mistake thinking they're filled with the Spirit when they receive Jesus. Talk about the Holy Spirit. When you receive Jesus, you're filled with the Spirit of Jesus. He has a Spirit. It is good, it is holy, it is righteous. And it is to come in and cleanse and bring life to you. But then Jesus says, I and the Father are going to send you the Holy Spirit, and He will be around you, but I want you to know in the future He will live inside you. So when I received Jesus as a good Southern Baptist, Jesus was in me. But then when I received the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit went from out here to in here, and it began to do something. Now, don't be alarmed. If you just received Jesus, you need time to grow. He's incubating you. You're in the toaster oven of the tummy, ready to be birthed. And the Holy Spirit is holding you and saying, take Jesus' truth. Take him as your master, developing spiritual eyes, spiritual toes, spiritual noses, developing little feet that can be in the kingdom of God, developing lungs that can breathe in a different environment called the kingdom of God. And eventually, when your faith grows enough in Jesus and you receive his word seriously, when he commands you to receive the Holy Spirit, go and receive the Holy Spirit. It's a command. It's not a suggestion. When you do that, you'll be birthed into a kingdom of reality where your eyes can see things they could not see before. So, for the mind set on self-centered purposes called the flesh is death, but the mind set on the Holy Spirit is life and peace, because the mind set on the self-centered purposes called flesh, it is hostile to God. If you got a crib full of your toys, you are hostile to God, as you realize, because the mind is set on that, right? And the toys reflect that. There's some people that I know that don't even want you to come to the house because they don't want to see all the toys they got. They don't want to see where they wasted their money. You can see, well, wow, okay, that's your God. That's your God. You're pretty safe, I see. Wow, it's stacked to the ceiling. Wow, there's a TV that cost $8,000. Wow, there's a chair. And I know, you had to have the best. That's a $4,000 chair. You know, come to my house and see my $20 chair. Wait a minute, we got two chairs. They're $2,500 a piece, those two chairs are. But we paid $25 a piece for them. So. But they are. You can still order them on the net. So the flesh, it's hostile toward God. And here's the problem. We can't recognize the flesh. Not if you're self-centered. If you're self-centered, then you're going to try to use God to get what you want. But if you're not self-centered, matter of fact, it says that the flesh, it's hostile towards God. So if someone shows up on your doorstep and says, you know, here's what Scripture says. It's hostile towards God. For it does not subject itself to the instructions of God, for it is not even able to do so. For those who are in self-centered purposes called the flesh cannot please God. Do not deceive yourself. You cannot please God if you're in self-centeredness. Now, why am I talking so much about self-centeredness? Obviously, there's a reason for that. It's because it's the thing that will shut your hearing down so that you can't hear what God's greatest is, because what you want to hear is what your greatest is and you want your pleasures. It's the thing that will shut His voice down. So we must recognize it as the thing that will shut His voice down. The mind of man cannot hear from God. The old Adam. Let's go on here. Romans 8:14. For all who are being continually led by the Spirit of God, these are the mature sons of God. If I come to your house and you said, I am continually led by the Spirit, and you've got $40,000 stuff surrounding you, I got news for you. You are not led by the Spirit. If you've got to have the latest and greatest, you are not led by the Spirit. If you've got to ingratiate self and it's all about you, you are not led by the Spirit and you are not a mature son of God. We are supposed to be continually led by the Spirit in all of our decisions, so that if we reach out to do something, it's not for self. And if it is for self, you've missed it. Now, does that mean you won't have a new car? I'm telling you, God can send you a new car. Now, if you go out and get a new car, it's going to be the best and you're going to pay $50,000 for it and you're going to be in debt and it's going to take away your future. Become friendly with the Holy Spirit, and He will begin the process of growing you up. You've got to understand, if you're going to walk in the Spirit, it's to get you away from the flesh, the stinky self-centeredness. It's to get you away from that. If this guy that was driving this ship would have received a message, start your engines. Matter of fact, he would have received a message before he left, because wherever this ship came from, I think it was Spain. There should have been a survey done on that ship, and I'm sure there was. If you go back and look at the paperwork, there's probably all kinds of surveys that was done and docked saying, your ship is not seaworthy. Your engines, they got great problems. Don't try to make this voyage. I'm sure you'll find that on paper, because there is nothing more arduous than the sea world when it comes to being seaworthy. Even the poorest countries will say, you got a piece of junk that's going to sink, fix it. And you can't even park it here because it's going to sink. So every nation has its own requirements that the vessel is supposed to be seaworthy. This one right here wasn't seaworthy. We saw it break in half because it was in the wrong position. You know why it got in the wrong position? Because it headed out to sea with its cargo because it wanted to make money with the cargo. Because its engines were not any good. And so when it got out to sea, its engines failed. And when the engines failed, the sea does what the sea does. Become friendly with the Holy Spirit and begin to grow up in Him. Now, principle number 5 I want to bring to you is hearing and obeying. We talked a little bit about that in our last session. Not much, because we were covering some of the things the Holy Spirit requires of us. Hearing is not normal to us. The old Adam in us is deaf. So if I want to revert into the flesh for self-centeredness, can I hear? If I have to have something, a toy, can I hear? And I've learned about myself that if I, I got to have that. Matter of fact, I bought a boat one time. It was a sailboat. I was out on the East Coast. You know, it was like a $90,000 used sailboat. It had been more than that if it had been new. And it's just sails, life, it's got everything. Well, it received some damage out there and some hurricane. And as a result, I think I paid $3,500 for it. Now, I had to go to Jackie at least 5 times to convince her that was God's will. But Jackie, it's only $3,500. It's a $90,000 boat. This would be equivalent of a 40-foot boat with 12-foot beam. Dinghy stanchions on the back of it. All the riggings, all that stuff. Beautiful boat. I paid another $2,000 to get it shipped from the East Coast to my backyard and started working on it in my backyard. All the time, Jackie just, honey, and she told me, start off with it. I said, Jackie, I just, man, you know I've always wanted a boat. She said, yeah, I know that, honey. I was totally enamored that I could get it for that price. And I looked at probably 400 boats while I was out there that I could buy. I picked this one for a particular reason. And her first response is, I'll pray. She came back. I don't believe it's of God. We don't have any need for one. It can't be used in His kingdom. Boy, I hate that when somebody does that. God probably wants to bless this and we can make some money. If I do the repairs back home, we could probably sell it for a quick $50,000. It's got to be God's will. I mean, why would He send it? Why would it be there? You hear anything in there? See, I've learned when you want something, you cannot hear from God. That's why we need some outside sources that gets it away from our self-centered orientation of making a decision. I bought the boat, of course, after Jackie said, I'm not in agreement that this is the Lord. But it's got to be. And she said, well, honey, you're the leader. And you're the one that have to make the decision. I've given you my input. And I do not believe it's of God. I got it home and got it all set in the backyard and big truck and crane and set it up on blocks and all that stuff and started working on it. And one of our parishioners from the church come over one time and they wrote down the name of it, you know, and took it home and Googled the name. And then they called me and said, Curtis, the name of that boat that you think sounds beautiful, its name was Perfidia, you know? I was going to change that. And she said, do you know what that name means? I said, no. Unfaithful one. I failed many times in my life, and I've learned there are some areas in my selfishness that I can't hear the truth. I can't. Why? Because your mind will make it up. See, remember we studied the lobes of the mind? You got that reptile part that the enemy can speak to, and you got another part that is all about self. Self-preservation, me, myself, I. There's a whole part of that, a whole section of the brain. And it's one of the larger sections of the brain, one of the more active sections of the brain. But then you got 2 frontal lobes. And if you will respond to God, those frontal lobes begin to grow and you won't have a shrinking brain when you get older. But if you are non-responsive to Him, you can pray in selfishness and your prayers are held back here. And that lobe doesn't grow. But if you pray in the Spirit and pray in truth for God's will, which doesn't have to do with self, then it will shut the self part down. Self is death, remember? Self is death. We cannot look at it that it can bring us life. The old carnal nature cannot hear God. The Scripture says we must cultivate the ability to hear His voice. The Holy Spirit is the only one who can impart the ability to hear God's voice. Self is one of the things, the major source of being able to turn off the radio. It instantly, if it's something that's called self-dealing, it instantly shuts off your ability to hear God. You've just lost it. Not on a permanent basis. You turned it off. Why? Because self is in operation. You got the big self radio going. You ever see one of those big old radios with a horn on it, you know, sticking out? When you hit the self button, that thing, it's all about self. But I think I hear God saying. No. Self will lie to you. Exodus 15:26. If you diligently heed the voice of your God, the Lord, your God, and do what is right in His sight, and give ear to His commandments, and keep all of His statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians. For I am the Lord who heals you. And I hear many people quoting, God is the one who heals me. But yet, they're all into self. What did God say? He says, if you won't do what they did, if you'll diligently heed my instruction and do what I say through my Scripture, through the Spirit, through my leaders, if you will do that, then I won't put the diseases upon you that I put upon Egypt. And I will be your healer. Many people invoke God as their healer, but yet unwilling to look at the aspect of, are you going to obey His voice? Matter of fact, I didn't put another scripture in there. Another scripture made the statement that when the Israelites left Egypt, the first thing that happened, they came to a place and God made a covenant with them. And His statement was, if you'll hear my voice, then I will take you as my people. If you hear my voice, then I will take you as my people. And in Jeremiah, I think it's chapter 7, I may even have that in there. We cultivate this relationship with God and His greatest for us by learning Scripture, by being obedient to what it says, by receiving the Holy Spirit, and getting certification of what He says from your shepherd, leader, overseer, and do it. Why? Scripture says, let everything be established by two or three witnesses. You've got to have a witness, and that's not your barber, and that's not your bartender. A witness is someone who can stand in the presence of God and intercede for you and ask, God, is this your will? Somebody that's independent, neutral, third party, they don't have a vested interest in your selfishness. And they will identify it. Well, no, that's selfish. Ugh, that's not a man of God. He didn't agree with me. Right? Paul put up with this. Jesus put up with this all the time. Part of the certification is that if we do what the Lord instructs us to do, we'll fall in love with Him. If you have a problem with your love for Him, it's because you love yourself more than you love Him. And the enemy will convince you to be about yourself. We're going to go on here because we've got a lot to cover. I did not speak to your fathers or command them in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt concerning burnt offerings and sacrifice. But this is what I commanded them, saying, obey my voice and I'll be your God. What's the deal? Obey my voice and I'll be your God. If you don't obey His voice, you got a problem, because this principle was carried straight over into the New Testament. And He also made the statement, I will be your God and you will be my people. What distinguishes us about Christians? It was carried straight in the New Testament. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. Again, it came down to the single factor. And matter of fact, in this same passage in Jeremiah, He said, it wasn't about the sacrifices. See, the sacrifices came later. What God said was, I want you to obey what I say, when I say it, how I say it, and do it. Then the sacrifices were part of His voice that he told them and gave them some instructions later on. But what made them the people was not the sacrifices, not the rituals, and not the tabernacle. What made them the people is they wanted to hear the voice of God. The whole covenant was based upon hearing him. New covenant with Jesus is my sheep hear my voice, and I know them. John, I don't know, chapter 10. People who belong to Jesus are people who hear his voice and follow him. If you don't hear his voice, you can't follow him. And if you're following self-pursuits, guess what? You're not hearing his voice. So, what do we need? Principle number 6, certification of what we hear. What scripture got for that? Remember, we always got to refer to scripture. 1 Timothy 4:14, now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith and give heed to deceiving spirits. How are they going to deceive us? They say, God wants you to have this. And then Satan told Eve, hey, God, you'll be like God. God wants you to eat of that tree. And when God gave a direct instruction, don't eat of that. You're dead if you do. It's pretty simple. I'm paraphrasing that for you in a southern way. He says, give heed to deceiving spirits. They will give heed to deceiving spirits. So there are spirits with the intent to get us to set aside God's instruction. Get us to set aside what the Scripture says. I'm just absolutely amazed at how people will misapply Scripture on purpose. And that's why the Scripture says that no prophecy of Scripture is for private interpretation. And if you think that you hear from God through the Spirit, it's not for private interpretation. Why? Because you'll make it up if it has to do with self. If it has to do with God's kingdom and his purposes and his nature and his spirituality, it is not made up and is true prophetic and it is a gift to us that will help us change, be glorified. It will help. It says that prophecy is supposed to be the voice of Jesus in our midst. Now you think Jesus comes up and, oh, I'm prophesying to you that you need a $4,000 Rolex. Did Jesus say that to you? But yet somebody can say, well, God spoke to me and told me it was all right. You know? I don't think so. There are deceiving doctrines also. That is where we cast down the doctrines and instructions that Jesus has given us. And we decide to replace it with our own thoughts about what it says because we got some of the purpose in mind. Romans 13:14, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh, which is self-purposes, in regarding to your own self-fulfilling desires. Make no provision for that. If we make provision for self-purposes, we automatically go deaf. A lot of people ask me, well, they receive the Spirit and they walk for God. And I can tell you, I've seen many people receive the Spirit. I've seen many of them be for 15 years on fire for God. And then all of a sudden, well, it's not all of a sudden, they hide things. They're hidden for a while. And you wonder, well, what are you hiding for? And then after a while, you find out they've gone south. North, east, or west. They've gone somewhere else. They're not on the pathway anymore. How could they fall? I can remember the great meetings and they were praising and worshiping God. If you go in and examine their bank accounts and all their self-centeredness and all the things they surrounded themselves, they made themselves deaf. Deaf. And if you're deaf through your self-minded pursuits, death will follow. If you're deaf, death will follow. So we must guard our relationship with Jesus Christ and not let that die. It has to be alive. And he said, if it's alive, I'm going to live in you. And if he's going to live in me, he's going to take your body where he wants to do what he wants with instead of you doing what you want with your body, right? And I know this is really soothing to your ears. If we're not hearing from God, there are only two other sources we can hear from, and we can't call them God. Self, me, myself, and I. Remember the God, there's a God, Trinity, Father, Son, the Holy Spirit. And then the us being a God, that's me, myself, and I. We've got some purpose, our I long, and we make long-range plans to change everything God says so we can achieve that. Self-purpose, remember, flesh is dead. Demons appearing as agents of light and saying, it's okay to serve yourself. God would want you to do that. They invoke one into a violation of Scripture. They disqualify God's leaders, and they reject instruction and leadership. Remedy? God's got a real simple remedy. Because what are we after? We're after to hear his voice. That was his command, right? So if we're going to receive that command, then there must be some safeguards in Scripture. There must be some safeguards to keep us from going astray. Certainly God didn't want to speak to us and then let us go astray. Test what you think or hear and get it certified. What do you do with a car if you go to buy it? You want that dealer, you certify every part on it that you replace it if it's not like you say, right? So if you think you hear from God, take it to your shepherd. Look in Scripture first. You don't even have to go to your shepherd. A lot of times you'll find it in Scripture. It says, don't do that. That's stupid. Don't follow yourself. Don't say you're going to go here or go there, but only if the Lord is the one that instructs. Let everything be established by two or three witnesses. Say, there's a safety net, isn't it? You'll pick people who want to agree with you. That's why God wants you to use men of God that will not buckle, that will tell you the truth, because they don't want to attend your shipwreck again. They will. I can't tell you how many times I've gone to the same shipwreck and say, you forgot about the rocks there, huh? Let everything be established by two or three witnesses. Think about this. If you hear from God, do you think that it would be for your benefit? If it's on the spiritual side, I would agree. If it's on the flesh side, you need that outside voice that's not involved to say, you got all these trinkets and gadgets around you and you spent all your fortune on those things and this is another one of those things. It stinks. It's flesh. For whose benefit is it? Remember, what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to be denying self, are we not? Now, got a couple of scriptures. Instruction from Jesus. Do you think we ought to pay attention if it's special instructions from Jesus? Whatever we think we are hearing is to be brought into the light. Matthew 4:22 and 24. There is nothing hidden which will not be revealed, nor has anything been kept secret that it should come to the light. We're supposed to bring everything into the light. I try to stay transparent with you, which I have to stop and be transparent. I was driving on the way here, and I was going to go meet somebody, and I found out I was late, and so, I'll call them. You know, and I call them, and then, policeman. They're not supposed to talk on the phone. You know that, sir? Yes, sir. Thank you for stopping me. Thank you for doing your job. Praise God. This is great. And he looked at me, and really? Well, have you got insurance restoration? I start hunting and papers are flying everywhere. And I said, I'm one of those dumb drivers that you're just supposed to drive and it doesn't matter if you're legal or you got papers or anything. Finally, I did find the right papers and hand them. He come back to me and radioed in. He come back, hey, sir, stay off your phone. You can't do that while you're driving. And I said, well, officer, I have to tell you something. I thank you very much. And with the money that you just saved me, which he says it's $124. With the money that you just saved me, I'm going to go buy me a Bluetooth thing to go in my car. And he said, you better do that. And then I said, I'm a pastor of a church, and I have to be transparent before my people. I have to confess this in the pulpit. I was a violator of the law. I was a violator. There's many things in God's law that we violate, and he has a policeman that's called one of his shepherds that'll, can I talk to you for a minute? Where are your papers on this stuff? And our response to him determines the outcome of the fine, right? I didn't get a fine. Why? I was earnestly responsive. And I would have thanked him if he'd have gave me a $1,000 ticket because he is God's emissary for man here on earth. Everything's supposed to be transparent and out in the open. If anyone hears, he has ears to hear, let him hear. There's three principles that we want to look at right quick. Principle number one, we have to stop what we're doing and listen if we have ears. And have it tested. Have it tested. You can't test it. Your friend can't test it. Your spouse can't test it. Why? Because those are all in agreement with you. We can't multitask. We can't have dual purposes. If there's a flesh purpose in there, then you're not going to hear from God. Now, why am I hitting this so hard? Because this is the central reason of shipwrecked lives, of not hearing God in the Christian realm. This is the biggest problem for us who call themselves Christians. Do you realize, and you look around and you think, well, they were shipwrecked last year, and they were shipwrecked, and those people were shipwrecked, and man, what kind of Christian faith is it? It's one that's not listening. God wants you to avoid those. He has a nice safe harbor to receive something from Him. Don't multitask. Don't have dual purpose. You find you got a dual purpose. Oh, it can just really help me grow spiritually if I get that boat and I can spend lots of time praying out on the water. You know? Dual purpose. Recognize it for what it is. Call it what it is. Stop lying to yourself. Principle number two, listening to the right thing to increase our spiritual resources. Because He tells us, take heed what you hear. Did you see that? Take heed what you hear. Jesus is speaking this. Then He said to them, take heed what you hear. Most people don't take heed what they hear. They listen to the right thing to increase your spiritual resources. That's what you're supposed to be listening for. And with the same measure you use, wait. He's talking about hearing. Take heed what you hear. And with the same measure you use, it will be measured to you. What? Hearing has to do something with measuring of me getting something? And how it's going to be measured to me? Remember we talked about prosperity, and we talked about multiplication, 30, 60, and 100-fold? Excuse me. Then He makes this statement, and He's still talking about hearing. And to you who hear, no, with the same measure you use, so if your measure is God saying He'll bless me? Oh, I hear that blessing. They're talking about. Oh, they're talking about condemnation. Are they talking about blessing yet? Oh, no, they're still talking about condemnation. With the same measure you use, it will be measured to you. God says, if you're my son, I'm going to chastise you and discipline you. If you don't want the chastising and discipline, then you're a bastard. You're not born of God. You realize that? I mean, this is supposed to be a work out your salvation with fear and trembling for your whole life. There's no exit visa that gives you carte blanche. I wished I could issue a card. And when somebody said the magic four words, yes, Jesus, I want you as my Savior, here, from now on, you can do whatever you want. Says so on the back. Just invoke the card. Do what you want. Live the way you want. Because you got your pass into heaven. I got news. When you get there, Jesus is going to say, I don't know you. You were a worker of iniquity. You did what you wanted. You were self-pursuit. You did everything for yourself. I don't know you. Go away from me, you worker of iniquity. I'd much rather you despise me and me telling you this, then me have to face God and Him say, why didn't you tell Him? A little self-interest there, I think. He goes on, if you hear, you'll end up with something. And then because He see that you took it, oh yeah, thank you, Lord. Like that guy was going to give me a ticket. Yeah, thank you, give me that. I deserve that. He said, if you're willing to hear, then He'll give you more. For whoever has, that means you received what He's got, you got it, and you're not letting go to Him will be given more. To you who hear, more will be given. To him who has, because he has heard, will be given more. Then he goes, just still Jesus speaking, and He said, but whoever does not have, you didn't receive what you didn't want what He said, even that which he has will be taken from him. Wow. That's why I meet many Christians that they can't get on in their spirituality because they don't want to receive His instruction of what He had to say. And He says, if you don't want to receive what I have for you, then what you had, all those experiences you had, remember the Christian has been walking for 20 years? All those things are gone. And there's spiritual bankruptcy that comes as a result of not being careful of what you hear. We're supposed to hear from Him rightly. It's supposed to get it judged to see if it's from Him. Everything that goes on inside the church is to be judged. Everything in the world, we're not to judge anything out there. Who cares about that? But anything that calls itself God is supposed to be judged. If there's a word that comes forth from the pulpit, you're supposed to be judging it. That's your duty, your responsibility, to keep honesty and purity in the sanctuary of God. If you speak of thus saith the Lord, then that has to be judged by me and the body. And if someone says, I think God's speaking to me, and I get this prize, and I get this, and I get to go do this, and he's, you know, I'm free. I can do what I want. No, you can't. That's self. It has to be identified. Wrong hearing decreases our spiritual resources and takes us into bankruptcy. I've seen some people's bankruptcy take 5 years. They start decreasing because they don't want to hear it, didn't want to hear it, don't want to hear it. 5 years later, they're bankrupt again. Both spiritually and most of the time physically. I've met many Christians who years ago were rich in the presence of God. They no longer walk with Him. Why? Because they didn't want to do what He said. What happened? They lost their ability to hear. They ceased to cultivate the ability. They began to listen to wrong things, self-dealing, self-directing. You have not because you ask not, and when you ask amiss that you might spend on your own pleasures. That's what Scripture says. They cut off God and opened themselves to self-seeking pleasures, calling it God's voice. Jesus also tells us to be careful how we hear. He told us to be careful what you hear. Now He tells us to be careful how you hear. And it has the same penalties as the other one had. Did you realize that? Therefore, take heed how you hear. Now, do you think it's important that Jesus Himself is speaking this? And He also, you think it's important that Jesus Himself is the one that spoke? Be careful what you hear. We're willing to accept all manner of stuff from everyone. Slander is Satan's first name. I don't know if you know that. It's one of his names. Gossiping is connected to that. Wherever he goes into the same thing, the multiplication for the hearer, how you hear has to do with what's inside you. Do you really want to hear from Him? It's the way we open up to God and be transparent. How you hear Him. I come to Him and, oh God, I'm a dirty, rotten, filthy beast here on earth. The only good thing is in me is You. And I need You. I need Your transformation. I need Your presence. Everything is about on the spiritual level, right? What if I come to Him and got 47 things I need to talk to You about that need to be supplied in here, God? Or praise God, He's given me this. He's going to give me this new and this new and this new. None of that is God. And that's not approaching Him. And that's not that the how before Him is our response, our reaction. Is it in the spirit or is it in the flesh? Are you approaching Him with self-centeredness, self-dealing? Is that your purpose for approaching Him? If it is, you're going to be surrounded with all your stuff. If it's not, then you're not going to be surrounded with your stuff. Instead, you're going to say, Lord Jesus, I need You, and I need Your transforming power because I see I got a whole bunch of stuff piled up around me, and my sticky little suction cup fingers won't let go of it. Oh, God, help me. You might need some amputations to get you to release some of the garbage that you've been hauling up for yourself, and God will oblige you. He will help you in that, but you'll also be free and be able to stand in His presence and grow new fingers that will be able to hold the things of God. That's what we need to be holders of. The way we approach Him determines how God imparts Himself to us. See, talking to Him, if He's going to speak to you, He's going to be imparting Himself to you. He's not interested in just giving you some instructions. He's interested, let me place my heart within you. He wants to impart something to you. He wants to impart the revelation of Himself, the revelation that you can walk with. He wants to impart life to you. He wants to impart spirituality to you in that conversation. So how do you come to Him? Because Jesus has made this statement of how you listen. Job 12:11. Does not the ear test words as the palate tastes food? I think I'll finish with this. Our palate's very sensitive if we take time to test food. I have one of those super palates. I do. I could have been, if I liked the taste of wine, I could have been probably the greatest wine tester in the U.S. And I think many of you would attest to that fact. not about wine, that just, I got about 2 million taste buds on my tongue. The average person probably has one, you know. And so I can smell something from a long distance. And matter of fact, we go in a restaurant and Jackie will ask me, man, I love this. Sniff it out and taste it so we can make it at home. And I can figure out all the ingredients that are in it and the amounts of those ingredients just by smelling it and tasting it. That's the way the wine testers are. They've got special taste buds that they can tell how long it's been aged, what kind of wood it was, what kind of smoke if the barrel was there. They can tell you everything about it. Well, I can tell you that if you get something in your mouth, even if you got one taste bud in there, and it's dead, you spit it out. You know? Now, your nose should have sensed that long before then, right? Those things have definite smells. Well, I'm telling you, anything concerning self has a smell to it. It's dead. It's a dead animal you found beside the road. It says it'll feed you. Just as a mouth has taste buds, the ear also. If it's about flesh, self, in any way, shape, or form, we're supposed to spit it out. We're supposed to walk in this life, because suppose there's a bone attached to it. Well, you put it in your mouth, if there's a spiritual part, there's a bone in there. Well, spit the bone out. When you hear something that doesn't match Scripture, when you hear things that are negative about God and about spirituality, about your spiritual family, about the Word, Scripture, God, if you hear anything negative, man, I'm telling you what, you got somebody else's dead piece of meat that they're trying to give you, or maybe your own. Spit it out. God's given you ears. Line it up with what Scripture says, and peace will come. Because so our spiritual hearing is keen, and we talked about that. Let's go on here. The greatest thing is hearing God's voice, and it will increase our faith. Do you want your faith to increase? Remember, we're supposed to have faith that can move mountains. Have you got there yet? Well, you empty your crib of all of its toys, and you might get there. This is a definite way to get faith from God. It's become obedient to the Spirit, obedient to the Word. So faith comes by hearing. So if I get rid of my selfishness, I get to hear. And hearing by the word of Christ. Hearing when Jesus speaks. One translation said, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And they used the word rhema in there, which means rhema, logos is what was written, but rhema is faith comes when God is standing there speaking to you. There's where we get faith. That's why he said, I want my sheep to hear my voice. The Scripture is a magnifying glass as to whether we're hearing his voice or not. And then his witnesses are the other balance and check system. But God wants to build your faith up. He wants to give and impart faith to you. That's why he wants the conversation to be between you and him so your faith can grow. So that you honestly can know when to pray for somebody and see them healed. So you honestly know how to follow him. Everything that we do in life must have faith attached to it. If it doesn't have faith attached to it, it's not pleasing to God. If it's got flesh attached to it, do you think you found faith and are in faith? You cannot. My summation in closing for the eighth time. Find faith. You'll find it by learning how to listen to him. Apply Scripture and rule out self-dealing. Then truth will abound. And then his blessing will overtake you. Because he also made the statement that if you hear his voice, that blessings would overtake you. They would chase you down. If you would hear his voice, then you would be, instead of the tail, you would be in the front. That all of his provisions would be made for you if you'd hear his voice. There's nothing anyone will need if they can just hear the voice of God. And there is no shipwreck for those who can hear the voice of God. When you get on board a ship like that, before you ever got on it, if you could hear the voice of God, he could say, there's a dumb captain up there fixing to do some dumb things. Don't get on that ship. And if you're the captain of that ship and you could hear his voice, he could say, you are grounded until you get your engines fixed. God needs to speak that to us so that we can live in a safe environment. Elsewise, we plan disaster for our future, and he wants us to avoid that disaster. He so desperately wants you to avoid disaster that he begs us to follow him, begs us to come and listen to his voice, and then makes it simple of, here's a simple thing. Just get yourself out of the way, and you'll hear from me. Shall we bow our heads? Lord, I come before you, Lord, in a powerful word. It hits me in my heart. Brings conviction to me, too. But wouldn't that bring freedom? So come and touch us with your freedom. Cause your word to enter us. We desire, Lord, your greatest for our lives. And we're tired of our meager existence under what we have and under our direction. So come, give us your truth and install it in our heart that we might live it. And thus save our lives in your presence forevermore. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Praise God. Well, praise God. We are moving right along. No prayer meeting tonight. So you got an extra short sermon today.